Happy New Year and welcome to Tell the People, a program about our Catholic faith with news and information in and around the Catholic Diocese of Lafayette. I'm Trista Littell, and in today's show, we will interview Deacon Anthony Ozan, who will be speaking with us today about the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Mass and Award Celebration. Father Michael Russo will share his reflection in the segment, What It Means to Be Catholic. And in this segment, a conversation with Bishop Michael Jarrell, Monsignor Richard Green interviews Bishop Jarrell about a look ahead at this new year of 2015 in the diocese. But first, Catholic news on this January 4th weekend. A holy hour for vocations and the spiritual renewal of priests is held monthly. For the month of January, it will be held on Monday the 5th from 6 until 9 p.m. at St. Patrick Church, located at 406 East Pinhook Road in Lafayette. Please join us for an optional rosary prayed at 5:30 p.m. Food for the journey will be held at Hotel Acadiana, located at 1801 West Pinhook Road in Lafayette on Tuesday, January 6th. There's an optional lunch buffet available at 11:30 a.m. The program begins at approximately 12 noon with a speaker from 12:10 to 12:45 p.m. Full of Grace, Women in the Abundant Life Foundational Study, authored by Jeanette Benkovic, will be held on January 8th at St. Peter Church Hall, located at 102 North Church Street in Cairn Crow, from 9:30 to 11:30 a.m., and it resumes from 6 to 8 p.m. in the evening. CODA, 12-step meeting for building healthy relationships, will meet at Immaculata Center, located at 1408 Cromwell Drive in Lafayette, on Thursday, January 8th, from 12 to 1 p.m. There will be no meeting New Year's Day. Individuals are welcome to join us weekly on Thursdays in a safe environment to share their experience, strength, and hope for building healthy relationships. Leave No One Behind is a bereavement support group for parents and grandparents who have lost children in pregnancy and beyond. This group meets on the second Thursday of each month and will meet on January 8th from 6:30 to 8:30 p.m. inside the new CCD building of Saints Peter and Paul Parish, located at 1110 Old Spanish Trail in Scott. For more information, please call 356-5695. And also, St. Peter and Paul Catholic Church, located at 1110 Old Spanish Trail in Scott, is having Companions Along the Journey Bereavement Support Group. This meeting will be in the church hall, room number 1, on January 8th from 6:30 to 8:30 p.m. Companions Along the Journey Support Group offers a safe, non-judgmental place for people to do their grief work through prayer, meditation, education-based articles on understanding grief, and small group sharing to honor and acknowledge the reality of personal loss of a loved one. Opportunities for participants to find strength in the shared activities in order to move through the losses of life with hope for renewed vision is the focus of the support group. There will be a March for Life at 8:30 a.m. on January 10th. It will begin at Sacred Heart Catholic Church, located at 200 West Main Street in Broussard, with featured speaker Dr. Damon Cudahy. It will proceed to St. Joseph Church, located at 232 St. Deporus Street in Broussard, and return to Sacred Heart for refreshments. The rosary and prayers will be prayed during the March for Life. For more information, please call 230-2009. The Right to Life Walk on January 10th, praise and worship music begins at 8 a.m. at St. Edmund Church, located at 4131 West Congress Street in Lafayette. The opening prayer with Bishop Jarrell begins at 8:30 a.m., and the Right to Life Walk begins at 9 a.m. to St. Mary Catholic Church at 419 Doucette Road, and returns to St. Edmund Church. For more information, call 988-5580. Join us for an evening at the Petroleum Club with best-selling author Christopher West on January 16th for a couples date night. The buffet dinner will start at 6 p.m. and Christopher West will begin his presentation at 7 p.m. The talk for the night will be an overview of his new book, Feel These Hearts, God, Sex, and the Universal Longing. All couples are welcome to attend, dating, engaged, or married. The cost for the night will be $50 per couple, which will cover your dinner. Join best-selling author Christopher West as he presents a four-hour seminar on his book, Feel These Hearts, God, Sex, and the Universal Longing. The enrichment day will be held at the Cathedral of St. John the Evangelist Church on January 17th from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. Christopher West is a renowned educator, best-selling author, cultural commentator, and popular theologian who specializes in making the dense scholarship of the late John Paul II, the Second's theology of the body accessible to a wide audience. As founder of the CORE Project, he leads a global outreach devoted to cultural renewal through a dynamic and fresh proclamation of the gospel. The graduate course he teaches at the Theology of the Body Institute attracts students from around the world. His extensive lecturing, numerous books, articles, video programs, and media appearances, and has sparked an international groundswell of interest in the theology of the body across denominational lines. The Enrichment Day is open to everyone. However, there is a registration fee ranging from $25 to $65. Call 232-1322 for more information. And that's Catholic News for this week. Coming up next, we will interview Deacon Anthony Ozan, who will be speaking with us today about the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Mass and Award Celebration. Welcome, Deacon. How are you today?
I'm just fine. And you?
Doing well. Thank you. Before we go into the event we're going to be talking about, could you please tell us a little bit about yourself and where you're a deacon?
Okay. I'm a deacon at Immaculate Heart of Mary Parish here in Lafayette for the last 26 years. And I'm married to Mary Frances Ozan. And we have four children and nine great beautiful grandchildren.
How wonderful. Well, Christmas is going to be wonderful this year with all those grandchildren, huh?
Yes.
Well, please tell us about the event that you're here to talk to us about.
Okay. It's the annual Diocesan Mass and Award Celebration, where we honor the memory of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and also award people in different parishes for their great work that they do in their own parishes in memory of Dr. King.
Well, Deacon, when and where will this event take place?
Okay, it will take place at St. John the Cathedral, and it's at 7 o'clock in the afternoon, in the evening. So,
now, why is it important that we honor the memory of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.?
I think more than anything else, it is very important that we remember him for the great work that he did. Mostly, people refer to it as the great work that he did for the African Americans, but he did it for everyone because it was a great social movement in this country that brought about many changes. And I think one of the things, the great things that he did for us was to help us know that we are a people of service, and we are there to be of service to others. And he gave his life for that commitment that he made. So I think this is the most beautiful part of us remembering him and celebrating his memory of his commitment to other people.
And it was for all people. Well, on that note, who should attend this event, Deacon?
It's open to everyone, you know, because his work was done for everyone, not just for some, not just for certain races, but for all people. So everyone that has the opportunity, if they've never been before, should take the opportunity to attend this great event
Well, it's my understanding that in addition to the Mass, there's an award celebration. Who's being honored and why are they being honored?
The people that would be honored were people that were nominated by, you know, their pastors from the different parishes in the diocese, and they're being honored and awarded because of their service to other people. And one of the things that Dr. King once said, that one of the most persistent and urgent questions that we should all ask, what have we done for each other lately? Or are we doing anything for those, you know, among our community? So these people are people who represent people who have done great works in their own parishes, and they're being awarded for that.
You and I discussed earlier that there's usually a great turnout, and that some pastors have so many people doing service that they actually nominate more than one person.
Right.
So it's just so wonderful that out of the 121 parishes, you're going to have that many nominees,
yes,
or if not more.
Yes.
And Bishop Michael Jarrell's the celebrant for this year's celebration, and Deacon Ozan, you're the homilist for this
right.
solemn event this
right.
year. So for the members of our viewing audience who cannot attend this event, what would you like to share with them?
I would basically like to share with them that it's such an honor, first of all, for me to be been asked to be the homilist for this Mass, but also having been a part so much of, you know, the early years and the civil rights movement, that it is good for all of us to really come to a deep appreciation, you know, of what not only Dr. King did, but many people of all races that did for the freedom of those who were being oppressed in this country. So I think this is one of the greatest, you know, things that we could do in memory of Dr. King and all those who gave their lives for us so many years ago.
So once again, you said that will be held at the Cathedral of St. John the Evangelist
right.
on January 16th at 7 p.m.
Right,
okay.
Yes.
If anyone has questions, who do they contact, Deacon?
They can contact Ms. Stephanie Bernard here at the diocesan office, and she'll be able to answer any questions that they may have.
Well, we still have about a minute or so. Mm-hmm. Is there anything else that you would like to share with our viewing audience?
Yes, I would highly encourage everyone to, you know, if they're not knowledgeable of the great work that Dr. King did, that they would maybe go online or just ask someone who maybe were around in those days of the civil rights movement. The things in this, that he did and the great sacrifices that he did, as well as so many other people, that it was a great movement, not just for African Americans, but for all Americans. And always like to see, if there's one of us not free, none of us are free.
Absolutely.
So,
because we were one,
yeah,
for sure.
Right.
Well, there's a lot of unsung heroes out there,
right,
huh? So this
right.
is an opportunity for people to serve, and then for those, some of them to be recognized,
right.
So we hope that there'll be a great showing.
Right.
As you said, sometimes there's standing room only, so we hope that people right. will come and join in this right. wonderful celebration.
Mm-hmm.
Well, okay, Deacon, well, we certainly thank you for joining us and spreading the word about this wonderful event.
Okay, and thank you for inviting me to come.
Coming up next, Father Michael Russo will share his reflection in the segment, What It Means to Be Catholic.
Hello, I'm Father Michael Russo, the pastor of Our Lady of Fatima Catholic Church here in Lafayette. Today, throughout the world, the Catholic Church celebrates the great feast of Epiphany. First came the poor, the shepherds, now come men of wealth, magi, searching for Jesus as he lay hidden among the stars. God doing all that he can to attract our attention, calling us, begging us to seek him out. It is interesting that one of the greatest events in history, the birth of the Son of God, took place in King Herod's backyard, and he missed it. So caught up in his own ego that history tells us he had his wife and two of his sons murdered. You see, it's what happens when you live in suspicion and fear. And yet the message of the child of Bethlehem is not fear, but peace and love. And it's the message found right in the beginning in the list of names, which is Jesus' genealogy. It was the custom that only men appeared in Jewish family trees, and so how surprising to find in Scripture women listed in the family tree of Jesus. And even more surprising is who two of these women are, Ruth, a Gentile, a non-Jew, and Rahab, a prostitute. A prostitute in the family tree of Jesus. Do you see what's happening? In Jesus, walls come tumbling down. The wall between male and female, the wall between Jew and Gentile, the wall between sinner and saint. This is the real meaning of the visit of the Magi. God is no longer just the God of the nation of Israel. Now he is the God for all nations, for all peoples and languages. Yes, the walls of the world come tumbling down. But often we erect walls between ourselves and others out of fear, don't we? We're back to fear. We let fear dominate. Another year comes, another year goes, and we just make it up as it goes along. But you see, God has something better for us. He wants to help us live our life with vision and purpose. Life without a vision is a dangerous experiment. Simply hoping that tomorrow will be better than today, well, it rarely is. Dear friends, where there's no vision that you've been placed on earth to matter deeply to others, you live in loneliness. Where there's no vision for a thriving, godly family, you contribute to a broken, angry one. Where there's no vision for meaningful work, you live for 5 o'clock. Your goal becomes simply to survive and pay bills, often drowning in debt in the richest country on earth. But God made you for so much more. Do we really believe that God sent us his son so that our greatest life goal would be to someday retire? Do we think God put us on earth just so we would not have to work another day in our life? Is this the true meaning of life? So we would stumble around for years without any clue as to why we are really here? O little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie. Above thy deep and dreamless sleep, the silent stars go by, yet in thy darkness shineth the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. There are too few hopes and too many fears. The wise men found Jesus only because they were not afraid to pursue their vision, not afraid to leave their comfort zones, not afraid to leave what was familiar to them to follow that star. So as 2015 begins, start your year with a focused vision, because the Lord wants to do more in you than you could ever begin to imagine, and he wants to do it this year. We can never become satisfied with where we are in the spiritual life, because it's so easy to become much too comfortable being just Sunday Mass Catholics, and some of us even struggle with this, passing up opportunity after opportunity to deepen our friendship with the Lord Jesus. Perhaps in this new year, we can sign up for an hour in an adoration chapel or participate in a weekly Bible study. We can sign on the dotted line in our hearts to attend another Mass during the week. You see, here's the vision for life in 2015. For some of you hearing this, 2015 will be forever marked on your tombstone. Is this doom and gloom? No, it's living with an eternal perspective. For the afternoon of life cannot be lived as the morning, and the evening of life cannot be lived as the afternoon. In the spiritual life, we must change, we must grow, we must go deeper, because in each passing year, we get closer and closer to our eternal destiny, an everlasting splendor or an immortal horror. I close with one of my favorite liturgical images, which takes place right at the beginning of the Easter Vigil with the blessing of fire. As the priest walks down a dark church with the paschal candle, the symbol of the risen Lord, the congregation begins to light their individual candles, and soon the entire church, initially dark and gloomy, is illumined with light. One candle doesn't do it, but when we bring the light of our own lives together, we can illuminate the world. We have it in our own hands, that gift, that talent that is uniquely mine. I dare to let it shine and use it for others. And we might think our gifts are not good enough. We might have put them on the shelf with the excuse, I'm too old, let somebody else do it. No, in 2015, find your candle again. Find your gift, because the church needs it and God needs it. Faith not fear, faith in that little child of Bethlehem. Yet in the darkness shineth the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. To my Catholic brothers and sisters, be at Mass this Sunday. Make a good confession soon. And until next time, God love you.
Thank you, Father Russo. Coming up next in the segment, a conversation with Bishop Michael Jarrell. Monsignor Richard Green interviews Bishop Jarrell about a look ahead at the new year of 2015 in the diocese.
Good morning and Happy New Year, everybody. And Bishop, Happy New Year to you and welcome.
Thank you. Happy New Year to you, Monsignor, and to all in our audience as well.
At this beginning of a new year, let's spend a few minutes looking ahead at 2015. So first of all, Bishop, what do you look forward to this year?
Well, I realize that every day is a blessing, so I look forward to every day in the year. But there are certain things that stand out. For example, the Carmelite nuns at Mary Mother of Grace Monastery here in Lafayette are commemorating the 500th anniversary of the birth of St. Teresa of Avila. St. Teresa was a reformer of the Carmelites 500 years ago, and the sisters continued to look upon her writings as a source of great wisdom and inspiration. The sisters here are having a day for priests on April the 20th. We will gather for Mass, and we'll have a guest speaker and a lunch and a tour of the cloister on the inside. You know, the sisters have a very special love for the priests of the diocese, and they pray for us daily. Mm-hmm. So we certainly enjoy our visits to the monastery.
And Bishop, what can we look forward to with regard to ordinations?
Two priests in June, Travis Abadie and Billy Massey, will be ordained priests, God willing. And also in June, three deacons, Alexander Albert, Joel Falk, and Michael Richard. These three will be ordained deacons this June, and then priests in June of 2016. You know, we've had our years of plenty. We've had 13 priests ordained in the last 2 years, mm-hmm. which is wonderful. But as we said, this coming year we have two, the following year three, the following year five, and then the following year seven. Mm-hmm. So we have a few lean years, and then things get better later on.
Okay. And Bishop, isn't this year special for you?
Yes, a very special year for me. I'll turn 75 in May. And by canon law at that time, a bishop has to submit his offer to resign his office. I have to submit that to the Holy Father. So I'll send that letter saying, according to canon so-and-so, I'm required to submit this. And then I wait to hear from the Holy Father. I don't know how that process goes, but he probably does some consultation. Some bishops are replaced within a few months. Some stay as much as 2 years. Mm-hmm. It just depends. But I know that this Holy Father wants to enforce that idea that those who reach 75 should be looking for another ministry in the church. Yeah. And that's what I expect will happen for me. Okay.
All right, Bishop, well, over the past few months, you have been discussing the possibility of a capital campaign in 2016. What is happening this year related to that?
Well, we have the feasibility study beginnings this month, and that will tell us a lot. The diocese will be celebrating its centennial in 2018, and we have needs that might be addressed. And the feasibility study will help us to know what kind of things the people will support. I have some thoughts. For example, our retirement fund for priests could use some bolstering. I think that we need a retirement facility for priests, assisted living facility. We have consulate and nursing home for those who need nursing care, but sometimes people need a place before they need to go to a nursing home. I think our seminary fund needs some embellishment. Our tuition, room and board for seminarians each year costs us approximately $1 million, and we're happy to do that, happy to pay it. It's a good problem to have, but it still takes money. So I think we can appeal to the people of the Diocese of Lafayette to assist in those ways and others. But I add, it is the feasibility study that will help us to determine what the drive will be for.
Yes. Okay. Now, Bishop, I understand that St. Martin, the tourist parish in St. Martinville, is also celebrating a big anniversary. Can you comment on that?
You're right, it is big. It will be their 250th anniversary. St. Martin of Tours was founded as a parish in 1765, and it is the oldest parish in the diocese and is considered the mother parish in the diocese. Now, that celebration has already begun, but there are several other things coming up. On June the 2nd, there will be a special mass for the rededication of the church that I will celebrate that mass. They've been doing for the past year some renovations, some improvements with the pews and the pulpit and different things the church needed. So I will celebrate that mass. But the main celebration of the celebration will be on November 11th, 2015, the Feast of St. Martin de Tours. And that mass will be celebrated by Cardinal Gérard Lacroix, Cardinal Archbishop of Montreal, who will offer that mass, because 250 years ago, this area was under the ecclesiastical government of Montreal, Canada. So that bishop there in Montreal had governance here of the church in Louisiana. So that will make that historical connection.
Bishop, 2 weeks ago, we talked about the year of consecrated life. What else will happen beyond our borders in 2015?
Well, with regard to the year of consecrated life, we know that certain things are going on. For example, the World Meeting of Families in Philadelphia next September. Pope Francis will visit at the conclusion of this meeting, and we look forward to a big crowd for a mass there. And we think also of the Synod of the Family to be held in October in Rome. There'll be a great deal of interest in this meeting about the church's pastoral response to the challenges of marriage and family in today's world.
Thank you, Bishop. And so let's pray for a year of grace in 2015.
Thank you, Bishop Jowell and Monsignor Green. We hope you have enjoyed our program because it is produced for you. And from all of us at the Catholic Diocese of Lafayette, Happy New Year, everyone. So please join us next week on this station as we tell the people about the Diocese of Lafayette and the good news of our Catholic faith.